I asked Scotty to sing that song because I think it's a great song to start a marriage series with. Did you hear the key line? I can't live with or without you. Does that sound like marriage? Sounds like marriage sometimes, right? I can't imagine living life without you. And then there's days that I just can't live with you. I can't live with you or without you. I think another U2 song we could have done is I Still Haven't Found What I'm Looking For. That would be a good marriage song too. Because marriage is magnificent. Marriage is beautiful. Marriage is one of God's best ideas. And marriage is really hard and complicated and complex and challenging, but it's worth it. We're going to dive in just for 4 weeks on this beautiful relationship called marriage. Before I start, I'm going to pray. Would you bow with me, please? Lord, there are days that marriage is really, really hard. There's other days that it's spectacular and magnificent. And then there's a whole bunch of days that are just normal. And you have embedded this relationship that sometimes is in the valleys and sometimes is on the mountain peaks and many times is on the plains, very specially for us. And it's beautiful and it's hard. And so as we take just a little time to remember how important it is and to learn how to grow together as a couple, I pray that you'd speak by your Spirit through me. I pray we'd have ears to hear. Lord, I know there are some who are listening whose marriage is really struggling. I know for a fact that people who are listening to me right now have even possibly given up on their marriages. And I pray that you would breathe hope into them today. And there are many who are just experiencing life as a married couple and growing a little bit closer each year, but would love to have new life breathed into their marriage. I pray that that would take place. There are some who are preparing for marriage, who are looking forward to marriage in the future. I pray that there would be words of encouragement and instruction for them to whatever we need. Holy Spirit, I pray that you would speak to us. There are some here who are not married and may never be married. And yet in this text, in these texts that I'll share today, there are beautiful truths for them as well. So just do what you need to do. I'm available by your Spirit. Speak through me. Use this time for your glory alone, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, grab your Bible and open to Matthew chapter 18 and Matthew chapter 20. Matthew chapter 18 and Matthew chapter 20. There is an inbred attitude that we all have that destroys marriages. An inbred attitude. It's an attitude we are born with, that we all have, that if left alone will destroy a marriage. It's subtle, but it's deadly. It's really easy to see in other people and extremely difficult to see in ourselves. Sometimes the Holy Spirit has to point it out. I saw it yesterday on the road. Actually, it was Friday. I was driving home and I saw road rage. I've heard about road rage. I've never actually experienced it personally. When I told Libby about this, she said, "Was the rage directed at you?" I said, no, it was directed at someone else. She goes, "Okay, let's hear the rest of the story." Yeah, and I was driving along the road. I heard someone yelling and screaming. And I looked back behind me and there was a big black pickup truck, brand new. And the guy who was driving the truck was just screaming at the guy next to him in a little white car. And the guy in the car was just trying to get away, and so the truck drove his car and parked it sideways across two lanes. This is in rush hour traffic. So the guy couldn't get past him. He's just yelling and screaming at him, and I'm just kind of going, whoa. The young man in the white car kind of wheeled around and got around him and went to the middle lane and all the way up to the stoplight. Of course, the truck pulled up next to him at the stoplight. I was behind the truck about 200 yards. I wasn't getting any closer. I saw him roll down his window and spit all over the side of the white car, yelling, screaming, using various finger gestures. The young man in the car was foolish. I thought he rolled down his window and they really started to go at it. The guy in the truck implored him to pull into the parking lot, and I found myself praying that he wouldn't, because the guy in the truck would have ripped him to shreds. It was terrifying. It's ugly. And it's an extreme example of this attitude that I'm going to describe for you today. It's an inbred attitude. We all have it. And if left alone, it destroys marriages. The attitude goes like this. Inside my circle, I'm in charge. Inside my circle, I'm in charge. The guy in the truck, his circle went all the way around his truck. Anything inside his circle, he was in charge. We need a circle. Inside my circle, I'm in charge. You see this attitude in your youth sports coaches. Have you ever run across one of these youth sports coaches? And inside his youth sports world, inside his team, he's in charge. Don't cross him. You see it in your management at work sometimes. You see it in room moms at school. I've got my little kingdom, and inside my kingdom, I'm in charge. Don't mess with me here. Out there, that's your stuff. In here, it's mine. I say that it's inbred because it goes back to the very origins of humanity. And in fact, it even goes back before that. One day in heaven, we have little glimpses of this in Scripture, but one day in heaven, God had the idea to create an angel. And he, in his creative magnificence, created an angel, and it was spectacular. It was awesome. And he created other angels, and they were beautiful, and they were powerful, and they were angelic. One day, one of these angels walked past a mirror. Wow, look at me, he thought. I'm spectacular. In fact, I'm so impressive, I think I could run this place. It did not go well for him. He was cast out of heaven. His name now is Lucifer. It was then too. And ever since then, he's been trying to convince people if they would just draw a circle around themselves, they could be in charge too. Then God created mankind, male and female. He created them. In his image, he created us. Angels weren't even created in his image, but we, as humans, are cut out of his cloth, created in his image. And one day in the garden, there was a conversation between Adam and Eve. And Eve said, hey, Adam, he said that if we eat this, we will have all the knowledge of good and evil that we need. If we eat this, we could run this place. We just introduced a second circle, didn't we? We have the Adam circle, and we have an Eve circle, too. And we have two people and two circles. If you go on reading in the Genesis account, you see what happens next is the curse comes on Adam and Eve. God knows exactly what they're doing. He told them, don't eat of that tree. They chose to. And so they, too, were cast out this time of the garden. But before they were cast out, God said, there's going to be consequences to this choice that you've made, and we're still reaping the consequences today. One of the things he said to Eve, he said, Eve, your desire will be for your husband, and he will rule over you. The word desire there means the desire to control. You will try to control this relationship, and he will try to control you. And that's been happening ever since. And so now we have Eve, the queen of her domain. And we have Adam, the king of his domain. And inside my circle, I'm in charge. And as long as this attitude persists, marriages suffer. So Sometime later, a little boy is born. He is born in Adam. Everyone is born into this word, in Adam. We are born from Adam. So we have the consequences of Adam's sin in us. And it doesn't take long for us to see this little circle concept in a little boy. Maybe it's Christmas when he's 3 years old or his third birthday or something like that. And mom and dad give him a nice big red truck. And he's so excited. And inside his little circle, he's playing with his little truck. And then some unsuspecting other little boy in Adam comes over and says, I want to play with that, and takes the little red truck. What happens? No, that's mine! You just came into my circle. Get out. In here, I'm in charge. I mean, as little kids, we see it, don't we? And then we start growing up. And basically what we're doing through middle school and high school is we're trying to establish our circle. We're trying to establish our boundaries. We're trying to expand it as much as possible. We want more and more influence. We want more and more power. We want more and more popularity. Some of us have very small circles. Some of us have very large circles. Regardless of the size, inside here, I'm in charge. One day, little boy meets little girl. Now, little girl's been growing up with the same attitude. Mine, 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 all the way through middle school and high school, creating her boundaries, establishing her little kingdom. But one day they meet each other. They're attracted to each other. They like each other. They want to get together. So they decide to get married. And on the wedding day, they stand there before God and witnesses. And he holds her hands, looks deeply into her eyes, and he thinks, I can't wait for the honeymoon. That's actually what he's thinking. Outside of that, he also thinks, you, my damsel in distress, are now safe. I, your king, will care for you. You will be my most loyal subject. Just do what I say. She stands holding his hands, looking into his eyes. And this is what she's thinking. If you think you're bringing that ugly dorm furniture into my house, you got another thing coming. And we have right here on the wedding day what I will call a clash of clans. It's exactly what we have, do we not? We have two clans. We have a kingdom here, and we have a kingdom here. And we are bringing two kingdoms together. And here's what I have noticed. I've noticed that when those two kingdoms overlap, there is tension. Because the only thing that's true about this kingdom is whatever happens here, I'm in charge. Can you see how this attitude can destroy a marriage before it even gets started? So what do? Well, we try to negotiate a merger of kingdoms. You see, the shocking thing after the wedding day is we realize we were wrong. We were both thinking the other person was going to come into our kingdom and be subject to us. But we were both thinking that. And we were wrong. So we negotiate a merger of the kingdoms, and sometimes this takes years. Some of you have been doing this for decades, still trying to negotiate a merger of the two kingdoms. So we have one bathroom, but we have separate closets because, well, we need closet kingdoms. They have to be separate. Some of you have separate bank accounts because you want to keep your finances separate. Why? Because you want to keep control over the money you bring in and the money he brings in. And we have our own cars in one garage. We have our own special little cars, our chariots, if you will. We have our own thrones, certain chairs that we like to sit in the house, and don't get in my chair, that's my chair. And we're merging the kingdoms, but in a much more esoteric way. There are negotiations that take place about the way we use our time. And so shortly after you get married, or maybe even in the courting time, the gentleman will say to the lady, you know what, there's something you need to know about me. This is something about the way I do my life. And that is, I watch college football on Saturday. It's just the way I am. I've done it my whole life. I did it when with my dad when I was growing up, all the way through college. I would wake up, I would watch college football, and I would go to sleep, and I'd eat some pizza somewhere in there. That's what I did. And so all I want to do on Saturday is watch college football. And you know what? In fact, that's what I'm going to do. From now on, I'm going to watch college football on Saturday. Just on Saturday, I just want to watch college football. It's not too much to ask. She says, okay, well, I'll give you that. You know what I did? When I was in college and all the boys were watching college football, me and the girls, we went shopping. So you can watch football all day Saturday if you want, and I'm going to go shopping all day Saturday. Does that work for you? And he's like, oh, yeah, I think that works for me. Yes, and we've negotiated a truce. We figured out a way for a while to make it work until, of course, ESPN starts showing college football on every day of the week. Now we've got a problem because our bank account can't afford that. And negotiating over time doesn't work. It stops working. So we try to overlap. And as we overlap, we experience tension. And where there is tension, there is conflict. And where there is conflict, many times there is combat. And if you look behind the conflict in your marriage, you will find either a king, a queen, or both protecting their circle, protecting their turf. That's where conflict comes from. And then the kids come along. I mean, we were doing okay. We were starting to merge this relationship. We were starting to figure it out. And then the kids come along, and they are such unruly subjects, these children, are they not? They don't do what we tell them to do. And here's what we start to discover. We start to discover that we have some kingdom ideas about our kids. We want our kids to be like little princes and princesses from our kingdom. And sometimes my circle is different from her circle, and her circle is different from my circle. And so we start fighting about things like how much allowance to give the little prince. Well, we didn't get any allowance in my kingdom when I was growing up. Well, I got $50 a week in my kingdom, and that's what, no! There's more conflict. Because we're trying to live in our circle in the context of a relationship that cannot survive circles. We're trying to merge two kingdoms. And if you're still trying to merge two kingdoms, your marriage has not yet taken flight, I can promise you. And as long as you continue to try and merge two kingdoms, it never will. In Matthew 12, Jesus said this. He wasn't speaking about marriage, but it certainly applies. Every kingdom divided against itself will be ruined, and every city or household divided against itself will not stand. Pretty straightforward. I'm in my circle. I'm in charge. As long as one, two, or both of us continue to think that, our marriage will never flourish. Some of you have a broken marriage in your background. You've gone through a divorce. And as you're listening to me describe this, you're thinking, you know, that's what happened to us. That's what happened. My kingdom was so valuable to me, it became more valuable to me than our marriage. I prioritized my personal kingdom over our marriage. And it cost us. Kingdom building and marriage are mutually exclusive, my friends. They are incompatible. You need to choose. You got to choose, will I build my personal kingdom or will I build a great marriage? That's your choice. So how do we build a great marriage as opposed to building a personal kingdom? Well, you know how they've started to do these memory verse songs? They're not all that new. In fact, I remember when I was a young man, one of the first memory verse songs I can ever remember. And it went something like this. And as soon as you remember it, I want you to join in. I don't want to sing a solo. Okay? Seek ye first the kingdom of God, remember? And his righteousness. And all these things shall be added unto you. And then we run out of words. Alleluia. Right? Okay, some of you haven't sung that for 30 years, but you remember it. It's a terrible song. It's a great verse. Great verse. Listen, seek first his kingdom. Seek first his kingdom. That's different from in my circle, I'm in charge. Totally different. In fact, it's the exact opposite. Seek first his kingdom is the exact opposite of seek first my kingdom. Kingdom building and marriage are incompatible. They're mutually exclusive. If you want a great marriage, leave your kingdom behind and live in his together. Let me say it this way. Erase your circle, and embrace his. Erase your circle and embrace his. Because you see, there's another kingdom. It's a bigger circle. Sometimes we forget about it, but it's there, and it's real, and it's magnificent. It's the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven. It's the kingdom that Christ brought. It's the kingdom he longs us to live in. And the only way we can truly experience it together as a couple is to erase our circles so we can embrace his. Turn to Matthew chapter 4. Matthew chapter 4. This is the end of the temptation passage when Jesus was tempted by the evil one, by Satan. And it says again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. And so he showed him, he took him on a tour of the world. Look at the magnificent kingdom here and the magnificent kingdom here. Look at all these amazing kingdoms. All this I will give you, he said, if you will bow down and worship me. I'll give you all these kingdoms, just bow down and worship me. Now what's ironic about this? What's ironic about this is that Satan didn't even have these kingdoms to give. He doesn't own these kingdoms. Satan's been lying this lie forever. This notion of being in charge in a kingdom is an idea born in hell, my friends. Satan promises, but he can't deliver. He can't deliver you a kingdom. Being in charge inside your circle, listen, being in charge inside your circle is actually a complete fantasy. You have no control whatsoever. It is completely an illusion of control. You can't dictate anything, even in your little circle. And if you believe you can, Satan's got you hoodwinked. Look what Jesus said to him in verse 10. Jesus said to him, "Away from me, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only." Satan, I'm not chasing kingdoms, said the King of Kings. Woo, irony. If ever there has been one person who had the privilege and the right to chase after kingdoms, it was the King. And he says, no, I'm not here to chase after kingdoms. It's not what my kingdom is about. My kingdom is completely other. It's totally upside down. It's different from anything you've ever seen before. Well, what's it about? Well, I'm going to worship the Lord our God and I'm going to serve him. That's what the kingdom's about. It's about aligning my life around what he wants, worship, and being available to live for him instead of for myself. And the disciples asked Jesus, hey, teach us how to pray. And Jesus said, okay, pray like this. Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be your name. You're a hallowed God. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We want what's going on in heaven to happen here. We want your kingdom to burst through the kingdoms of this world. Most of us live as though we're praying, my kingdom come, my will be done. It's the complete antithesis of what we are called to live as believers. I ask you to turn to Matthew chapter 18. That's another example of erase your circle and embrace his. At that time, the disciples came to Jesus and they asked, who then is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? Do you see the irony in this? Who's the greatest? What they're asking is, who's going to have the most impressive circle in your kingdom, Jesus? And Jesus just shakes his head. He's like, there's no circles in my kingdom. Circles in my kingdom, mutually exclusive. Didn't work that way. He called a little child to him and he placed the child among them. And he said, truly, I tell you, unless you change and become like little children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Therefore, whoever takes the lowly position of this child, underline that, the lowly position of this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. You know who the greatest in this circle is? The one who humbles himself or herself like a child. Who replaces this sense of self-importance with deliberately choosing a posture of subordination and surrender. Erase your circle and embrace his. He teaches us over and over and over again. But how do we do it? How do we, first of all, erase our circles? Well, I'm going to give you a little homework. In fact, over the next 4 weeks, what you're going to discover is that our sermon time is just me taking about 35 minutes to set up your homework. Okay? So here comes your homework. I'm going to ask you this week to spend some time erasing your circle and embracing his. Erasing your circle individually, embracing his together. Let me walk you through what this might look like. I'm going to spend a little time alone with the Lord to erase my circle. And this might take a little time because some of you have been living inside your circle for a really long time under the illusion that you're in control. So you're going to spend a little time with the Lord. Maybe you'll journal, grab your Bible, and just sit down and say, all right, Lord, my heart's desire is to erase my circle. I don't want to live this way anymore. I know that to try to control things is the flesh. I don't want to live in the flesh. I want to live in the spirit. I want to be available to you working in my life and in my marriage. And so I am going to make this moment, this day, the day when I choose to erase my circle of rulership. I no longer want to live under the illusion that I'm in control. I surrender my rights to you. I surrender my control to you. And then you start asking, Jesus, what areas of my life am I in control of? What areas in our marriage am I in control of? Reveal my little kingdom to me. I need to see it. I don't know what it is. And what he'll do is he'll remind you to look behind the conflict in your marriage, because behind the conflict is either a king or a queen who is protecting their turf. And so you look at the conflict you're having. What are you fighting about? Is it finances? Are you fighting about the money? Is it your sex life? Is it the way you spend your time? What are you fighting about? Look behind the conflict and you will discover, most likely, an area where you have dug your heels in and you are trying to control the situation. So you take that specific situation. Let's think about something that a man might struggle with. One thing that men struggle with is that they think their time is in their circle. It's my time, I'll use it the way I decide to use it, we think. But we'll take it a step farther, because a lot of men think this way. Not only do we believe that our time is in our circle, we believe her time is in our circle too. We believe that she was put on this earth by God to make our life easier. So she could actually invest 10 hours a day just coming behind us, making sure our life works, and we don't even notice. It's unbelievably self-centered. And as we're praying and as we're talking to the Lord, and we're saying, Lord, what do you want to reveal to me? He may say, you know what? The way you view your wife's time is completely unbiblical. It's not the way I view people's time in my kingdom. Your time, her time, it's mine. It's not yours. Set her free. Set her free to flourish and to use her time the way I'm calling her to use her time. And we pray, Lord Jesus, I surrender the need to control my time and my wife's time. I entrust it all to you instead. I don't want to be king of that kingdom anymore. It's yours. At the same time, somewhere else in the house, wifey is having a conversation with God. She's sitting down saying, you know what, Lord, I need to erase this circle. I need to be done. And from this day forward, I need to be done trying to control and run my own life. I'm done. I realize that control is of the flesh, and I have no desire to function in the flesh, because have you read the results of the flesh in Galatians chapter 5? Discord, disharmony, sinful crud. I mean, flesh just breeds death, and I don't want to be about death. I want to be about life. I want your spirit to breathe life into our marriage. And so I'm making this specific decision today to erase my circle. What does that mean? What areas, Lord Jesus, Am I controlling in our marriage? Reveal them to me. No, just look behind the conflict you're having, and behind the conflict you'll find either a queen who's protecting her turf or a king who's protecting his. What areas of conflict in your life and in your marriage are your fault? Where are you digging in your heels? Where are you fighting for your turf? And it may go like this. You may be journaling a little bit, and all of a sudden the Holy Spirit might talk to you about your lifestyle, the way you live. And not only the way you live, the fact that you've gotten very comfortable in your lifestyle, you like it the way it is. And even though maybe your husband is struggling to provide it for you at this time, you're demanding that he continues to. You're making sure he knows you expect certain things of him. And as you're praying, the Holy Spirit reveals this selfishness to you. And you're broken, and you're like, oh, I don't want to treat him like that. In fact, living in your kingdom looks totally different from that. I get that now. And so I'm erasing my need to experience the lifestyle that I've become accustomed to, and I'm entrusting that to you. I relinquish control of that, and I entrust it to you. You can see how going through this process, the Holy Spirit has a little room to do some serious work in our lives. I know what some of you are thinking. What if I erase my circle and she doesn't erase hers? Wah. Call the wambulance, right? Okay, so it might take your spouse a little longer than you to erase their circle. You are not responsible for your spouse. You are responsible to your spouse. You are not responsible for your spouse. That's between them and the Lord. Stop thinking about them for a minute. That's controlling. And just ask yourself, am I going to go before the Lord and do this or not? Am I going to erase my circle or not? Because if you just listen to me, if both of you will erase these circles, you can then embrace his. And friends, that's when your marriage will take off. So it's up to you. No one can do this for you. It's up to you. And so we're going to erase our circles, and then we're going to embrace his. Then we're going to do this as a couple. So here's what it's going to look like a little later in the week. After you've had some one-on-one time with the Lord to talk about these things, you're going to come together and you're going to have a conversation. And the first thing you're going to share in this conversation is you're going to share the kingdom circles you erased. Oh, I can't do that, Pete. Why not? Because, say it, then I'll lose control. If he knows what I erased, I'll lose the control of those things. That's the point. We're trying to get rid of the illusion of control. It's an illusion. You don't really have control. We're trying to eradicate the illusion of control from our lives so we can surrender and be available together to his lordship in our lives. So we'll share, hey, this is what the Lord said to me. And then you're going to ask one of the most important questions you'll ever ask. So did I miss anything? What do you mean? Is there any area in our marriage that I am trying to control? Is there any way that I'm trying to control you? Speak into me. And in the spirit, you ask for a heart to be receptive and to listen and to be available, because friends, we've all got blind spots. And even though you can't see it, your spouse can. Listen to your spouse. Ask the question, is there anything else? Is there any area where I'm controlling you or I'm controlling this relationship, and have a heartfelt conversation about that? That might take a while. Then, after that, you start to ask the question, okay, so what would it look like for us to embrace his kingdom? Well, and this is when God's word comes in. I asked you to turn to Matthew 20 as well. Flip over to Matthew chapter 20, verse 20. Because what I would encourage you to do if you want to learn what it means to embrace his kingdom as a couple is start reading through Matthew's gospel together, looking for the word kingdom. It's all over the place. Matthew loved to talk about the kingship of Jesus, the lordship of Christ, and so his kingdom, the parables, all the way through Matthew, they're all over the place. And just when you get to the first place where it says kingdom, get together and read it together and just ask a simple question. How different would our life be if Jesus did this in us? How different would our marriage be if he started to create this type of relationship in us? An example, Matthew 20, 20. Then the mother of Zebedee's sons came to Jesus with her sons and kneeling down asked a favor of Jesus. What is it that you want? He asked. She said, grant that one of these two sons of mine may sit at your right and the other at your left in your kingdom. Okay, so now mom is asking for her kids' circle to expand. Side note, no extra charge. Sometimes we're not trying to build our kingdoms, we're trying to build our children's kingdoms. Don't do that to your kids. Why would you want to put them behind the eight ball as children? We don't want them growing up thinking, I've got to build my kingdom. We want them growing up thinking, I get to express his kingdom. Totally different. All right, that's no extra charge. I just thought I'd mention it. Verse 22. You don't know what you're asking, Jesus said to them. Can you drink the cup I'm going to drink? Are you willing to suffer? Yes, we can, they said. Jesus said to them, well, you will indeed drink from my cup. You're going to suffer. But to sit at my right or left is not for me to grant. These places belong to those for whom have been prepared by my Father. When the rest of the disciples, the 10, heard about this, they were indignant with the two brothers. Why? Because they wanted the power positions. They were still learning. Jesus called them together. He said, guys, sit down, listen. You know that the rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their high officials exercise authority over them. In other words, the way of this broken world is to rule, to crush, to flex your authority muscles. But my kingdom's different, he says. Not so with you, verse 26. We're going to be different, he said. We're not going to seek to rule over people, to lord over people. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wants to be first must be your slave, just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. Here's another irony. The Lord did not come to lord over people. I mean, if anyone has the right to lord over, it's the Lord. And as the Lord, he says, I'm not gonna lord over people. I'm here to serve. My kingdom is about service. If you wanted to put a label over this big circle, you could write serving over the top. We are a kingdom of servants. It's who he's created us to be. And this great servant, Jesus himself, indwells us at the moment of conversion. And if we will surrender to him individually as a couple, and look each other in the eye and say, what would it look like if we actually lived like this? If Jesus actually did this through us, that we came at each other as servants, not as people trying to protect our turf. Can you imagine the difference in a marriage like that? What would change in our marriage if we embrace this? Ask each other that question. Start to dream of ideas, of ways. Ask the Lord, Lord Jesus, tell us, show us. Make it this joint spiritual exercise of discovery together. Beautiful. What would it look like for us to embrace his kingdom as a couple in his power and by his spirit? I've told you on a couple of occasions about Robertson McQuilkin's resignation. He was the president of Columbia University, and he had a very large circle of influence. But his wife, Muriel, started to struggle in her latter years with some form of dementia. I'm not sure exactly which form. And as it progressed, he came to realize that he needed to erase his circle and embrace his circle. And so he stepped down from his leadership position so that he could stay home and care for his wife. And I've never heard this before, but I came across this week a video or an audio of his resignation message to the folks at Columbia University and Columbia Bible College, and I'd love for you to listen to it. Just listen to these words.
I haven't in my life experienced easy decision-making on major decisions, but one of the simplest and clearest decisions I've had to make is this one, because circumstances dictated it. Muriel, now, in the last couple of months, seems to be almost happy when with me and almost never happy when not with me. In fact, she seems to feel trapped, becomes very fearful, sometimes almost terror, and when she can't get to me, there can be anger, she's in distress. But when I'm with her, she's happy and contented. And so I must be with her at all times. And you see, it's not only that I promised in sickness and in health, till death do us part. And I'm a man of my word. But as I have said, I don't know with this group, but I've said publicly, it's the only fair thing. She sacrificed for me for 40 years to make my life possible. So, if I cared for her for 40 years, I'd still be in debt. However, there's much more. It's not that I have to, it's that I get to. I love her very dearly, and you can tell it's not easy to talk about. She's a delight. It's a great honor to care for such a wonderful person.
It's beautiful. It's kingdom living. And I hope you caught it, but there's a beautiful line in there. He says, but it's not that I have to, it's that I get to. Here's what happens. When you can erase your little fiefdom, things that in the past seemed like have-tos become get-tos in his kingdom. Everything shifts. Everything changes. Can you see how crucial this specific lesson is? Erase your circle so you can embrace his. Let's pray together. Lord, my prayer is that there would be scores, hundreds, thousands of in-depth conversations this week between couples, between girlfriends and boyfriends and fiancés, even between some young single adults around a circle talking about what it looks like to erase their circles in their relationships. And Lord, that you would open our eyes as we spend time in your word. You'd open our eyes to what it looks like to live in your kingdom, in your spirit's power, as Christ expresses himself through us, not simply individually, but as a couple as well. Lord, my simple prayer is that more and more and more of our marriages would be two people in this grand circle of the kingdom of God sharing life together, as opposed to trying to merge individual personal kingdoms and struggling through it. Only you can do it, so I ask you by your power and in your spirit to do it. Transform our marriages, I pray. And I pray it in Jesus' precious name. Amen.